Okay, so welcome back. We have this week we have Tanay from IIT Madras, who's going to be telling us about some work on analog quantum black hole models. Tanay, go ahead.
Okay, sure. So thanks for inviting me to give this talk. And yeah, I'll be speaking about some very recent work and some ongoing work. The broad theme is analog quantum black hole models. So yeah, this is a nice painting that I myself made during the lockdown, inspired by black holes.
Wonderful.
Yeah, so this is, the talk is based on some work which came out in June with Ayan, Alex, and Hariram, and also some ongoing work with Niranjan, who is an undergrad at IIT, Prabha, who's a quantum information theorist, and Ayan again. Yeah, so this is the broad outline of how the talk will go. So I'll start off with the kind of longish introduction on all these aspects of how black holes process information, some paradoxes surrounding the same, and the Hayden-Preskill protocol. Then I'll describe the model that we have come up with to kind of understand all these properties of black holes. Then I'll show you that our model makes sense, and that it replicates some classical information processing properties of the black hole correctly. Then I'll come to some ongoing work which relates to computing the entropy in the page curve following very recent work surrounding the same, and some other interesting ideas we have about quantum circuits and so on. And I'll finally conclude. Yeah, so let me just dive right into it. We start by defining what an old black hole is. So the main idea is that you have a bipartite system consisting of the radiation, of the Hawking radiation, and the black hole interior. And you want to plot the entanglement entropy of the Hawking radiation versus time. And this is what is famously known as the page curve. Now, the page curve qualitatively looks like the plot given here for a unitary evaporation process. And I'll kind of argue why you start off at zero and end off at zero in the next slide. But this is the qualitative features of the page curve for a unitary evaporation process. Now, you expect that, okay, initially, as more and more radiation is leaking out, the entanglement entropy of the radiation increases, and eventually it bends over and falls back down to zero. I'll explain why you expect it to fall back down to zero soon. But the point of time where it turns over, this transition point, is called the page time. And for a black hole with the mass of the sun, let's say it's about 10^67 years. So none of the typical black holes you might encounter are past their page time. So what is an old black hole? Any black hole which is past its page time is what we'll refer to as an old black hole. So now coming back to this whole page curve picture, let's understand.
Sorry, how does 10^67 is not a meaningful thing for me, but how does the page time grow with mass?
It's some polynomial in mass, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
I don't remember what power exactly, but yeah.
So the larger the black hole, the longer the page time, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so now let's kind of understand this curve a little better. So as I said, you have this bipartite system of the radiation and the black hole. You trace out the black hole degrees of freedom, compute the reduced density matrix on the radiation subsystem, and compute the von Neumann entropy as you usually do. Now, initially, as soon as the black hole is formed, there's no radiation. So the outside is vacuum, and you expect the entanglement entropy of nothing to be zero. So the page curve starts out at a value which is zero because there is no radiation initially. And we assume that the black hole is starting out in a pure state. So now if the process of evaporation or this time evolution is unitary, if we start off in a pure state, you have to end up in a pure state because that's what unitary matrices do. So at the end of the whole process, you should also end up with a pure state, a joint pure state on this joint Hilbert space. So at the end, what do you have? The black hole has just evaporated away. All of its qubits have gotten transferred into the radiation subsystem. So you just have a pure state of the radiation. So that means the entanglement entropy of the radiation is zero, because the entanglement entropy of a pure state is zero. So you expect that you're starting off with a zero entanglement entropy and you're ending up at a zero entanglement entropy. But in the intermediate stages, as initially more and more radiation is being leaked out, you expect there to be some growth in the entanglement entropy given by this initial part of the globe. This need not be linear. I've just plotted some random function in Mathematica. But you expect some initial increase in the entropy. And at the end, it has to be zero. So there'll be some point of time where this guy transitions. So this is kind of the argument for why in a unitary process, we expect this qualitative behavior of the page curve. I hope this argument is clear. If not, you can ask me. Okay, I'll then go on to the Hayden-Preskill protocol. So the Hayden-Preskill protocol is some protocol you do to an old black hole. So now you have a black hole which is past its page time, and you want to study its information processing properties. The idea is you throw in some qubits. So Alice has some diary she wants to destroy. Some authoritarian government is after her and she wants to destroy some information. So she thinks, okay, I'll throw it into a black hole and maybe it just gets erased. So what Hayden and Preskill study is this process where Alice throws in some qubits into a black hole, and they try to understand if this diary can be recoverable from the radiation later on. So they assume that the internal dynamics of the black hole is just a unitary, which is a fast scrambler. And what they see is that if you throw in any qubits after the page time, they are very rapidly revealed in the Hawking radiation. So if Alice throws in some state into the black hole after the page time, Bob is some observer outside the black hole. He can recover the state of Alice's qubits by just doing some decoding operation on the Hawking radiation. Now the time it takes for this information to be available or to be decodable from the Hawking radiation is essentially the scrambling time of the black hole. This is what they argue in their paper. Now they have a nice circuit diagram, which I kind of redrew in my own way here. So let's kind of dig into what their protocol is.
Then I have a question. So does the scrambling time, is this what scrambling time means, or is this an independent concept that has been defined somewhere else? Sorry, I don't know anything about this field, so.
No. Scrambling time is just independently defined. It just turns out for their case that it's the same.
So what is scrambling time originally?
For a Schwarzschild black hole, it's just RS log RS, where RS is the Schwarzschild radius.
No, I mean, how does one define the scrambling time?
Okay. Let's say in a quantum many-body system, it's the time it takes where, so you kind of perturb the system initially and wait for the perturbation to spread. So the time at which you can't decode or recover the perturbation from a small subsystem, that's the scrambling time. So let's say you have n qubits and you kind of disturb one of them and you wait till the scrambling time. After the scrambling time, you won't be able to recover the perturbation from any 1, 2, 3 qubits. You will need order n qubits to decode it.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, so this is a completely independent concept from the quantum information community, and it's not really defined by Hayden-Preskill. I mean, it just turns out that their time is equal to that, or of the same order, not equal exactly.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, now just to dig into this whole protocol of Hayden and Preskill in a little bit more detail. So this is a kind of rough, sketchy looking circuit of what they're doing. So let me just go one by one by discussing each of the elements. So if you look in the left top corner, you have this ket psi a. So this is some state that Alice is throwing in into the black hole. The second line is the degrees of freedom or the qubits that are already existing inside the black hole. So I just label that by BH. Now, these degrees of freedom are maximally entangled with the Hawking radiation that has already gone out of the black hole. So I denote this maximally entangled state of the black hole interior and radiation by beta, which is what quantum information theorists would use for some EPR pair. So now this capital U is representing the internal dynamics of the black hole. So what U is doing is Alice threw in her qubit psi into the black hole. U is just mixing up that qubit with the qubits that were already inside the black hole. Now, after this mixing up process is done, you trace out a part of that system, or you throw out a part of the black hole plus Alice's qubit out into the radiation. Now, this is this second line in the middle between U and V. And the rest of it is just the black hole interior, which is the top line labeled by BH. So the process is Alice throws in ket psi a and BH get mixed up by U. You trace out a part of that system, call it radiation. And the other part of that system is the black hole interior again, which is labeled by the same name, BH. Now, Hayden and Preskill's claim is that if you collect all the radiation that had already gone out, this so-called early radiation, which was the bottom most line, and you collect the new radiation that has leaked out, which is the middle line, you can apply some decoding operation V to recover Alice's original qubit. So yeah, the arrow of time in this whole picture goes from left to right. So the decoding operation is applied on what is referred to as the late radiation and the early radiation. And their claim is that you can recover Alice's qubit by just looking at these two subsystems.
Can I ask a question? Like, is that like to recover this full information of the Alice's qubit, should we have to wait for infinite time, or in finite time we can recover?
No, this time scale is just, as I said, the scrambling time. For a Schwarzschild black hole, it's just RS log RS, where RS is the Schwarzschild radius. So it's a finite time.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Now, this is, why is this called? Any other questions about the diagram? Okay. Now, this decode.
I would like to ask something. Where have you made use of the fact that the radiation you'd have to wait till after you have gone past the maximum of the page curve? I don't see why that is important and where it is used in this whole thing.
That's in the bottommost, like left bottom state beta. So we need to assume that the black hole and the early radiation are sufficiently entangled. So at the page time exactly, they are maximally entangled because half of the qubits inside the black hole have been leaked out.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so Hayden and Preskill don't actually give a prescription for what this unitary decoding unitary V looks like. Their argument is very information theoretic, so they don't really construct a V, but they kind of argue why it is recoverable, why ket psi is recoverable from the radiation subsystem. But there were follow-up papers by Yoshida and Kitaev where they constructed V explicitly given some U. Now, Hayden and Preskill have some particular choice of U. They're choosing it at random with respect to some Haar measure or something, but forget about all that. The overall picture is clear, I hope, that Alice is throwing in some qubit, it's getting mixed up, and then the claim is that you can decode it from the late and early radiation. Now, you're basically just decoding Alice's qubits. There is no talk of decoding the black hole interior at all. So this is one of the reasons why they called it an information mirror. So this is kind of like you throw a ball at a wall and the ball bounces back immediately. So this is exactly what is happening. Alice is throwing some qubits into the black hole, and after a quick enough time, it is coming back out again. And Alice's qubit leaks out before you can start decoding the black hole interior. So that's why this whole idea of a mirror comes in.
Hi, can I ask a question?
Sure.
The last slide, can you go back, please?
Yep.
So in here, when you say that Alice's qubit is being decoded, do you mean that by acting on with some operator V, we can get a product state of this radiation and the Psi-A, or by decoding, what do you exactly mean?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Okay.
Not exactly, maybe up to some fidelity or some errors you can allow for, but yeah, essentially that.
Okay.
Yeah, if there are no more questions, I'll move on from hidden skill. So this idea of mirroring is what I'll come back to later in our model. But just to complete the whole discussion, there are many of these paradoxes surrounding how black holes process information. One simple one in the hidden Preskill context is just cloning. So just from quantum mechanics, we know that you can't have cloning of quantum states in quantum mechanics because quantum mechanics is unitary. So the thought experiment you can do in this hidden Preskill protocol is Alice, instead of throwing her diary inside the black hole, she just jumps into the black hole, taking her diary with her. So Bob just waits until the hidden Preskill time, which is the time scale after which the Alice's diary would be recoverable from the radiation. He decodes the message. He decodes Alice's diary from the radiation and jumps inside the black hole himself. Now, both of them are inside the black hole or inside the horizon. They talk to each other and verify that, okay, Bob also has a copy of Alice's qubit. So that means that you have verified that some cloning of a quantum state has occurred. So this is one of the issues which one has to deal with if you believe in the hidden Preskill protocol, that cloning might occur. If Bob can jump into the black hole and talk to Alice, he can verify that he has actually cloned her state. Now, there are other paradoxes. There's this famous AMPS paradox or the firewall paradox. These are named after the authors, but this was kind of built up on work by Mathur and Braunstein also. But the main idea here is that it's again similar. You are doing some thought experiment where Alice is jumping inside a black hole and there's some asymptotic observer at infinity, Bob, who's waiting outside. And they want to do some thought experiment to check if some fundamental quantum mechanical concepts are being violated. In the AMPS case, it is the strong subadditivity of the entanglement entropy which is violated, or put in a much more simpler way, there's this idea called monogamy of quantum entanglement, which is kind of a funny name to give it, but that's what it's called. So the idea is if two subsystems A and B are maximally entangled, then B cannot be maximally entangled with anything else. So entanglement is monogamous. B can't cheat on A with subsystem C. So it turns out the AMPS paradox is built on this idea of monogamy of entanglement. And they also need to do a similar thought experiment where Bob has to decode some information from the radiation and Alice has to jump inside the black hole. So there are some ways around these paradoxes. So these were proposed by Harlow and Hayden in 2013, and then a very concrete proposal came out this year by King, Tang, and Preskill. So the idea with these is very simple. So let's say you're focusing on the cloning paradox. Forget AMPS for the time being. The cloning paradox is Alice jumping into a black hole with her diary. Bob waits until the information comes out. He decodes Alice's state, jumps inside the black hole himself, and talks to her. So now both of them have a copy of the same state and they can verify with each other that they indeed do. Now the way around this is quite simple, at least conceptually. So the black hole takes a polynomial time in its entropy to evaporate. The black hole evaporation time basically scales as S raised to something.
Hello, I have a very naive question about the earlier statement in the earlier slide. Like this cloning paradox, you were telling that Alice with her diary both together simultaneously went inside the black hole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So like now when the diary's information came out of the black hole after scrambling time, also is it not that the Alice don't exist inside the black hole, or is her all the qubits also comes out of the black hole by that time?
Yeah, it is true that information about Alice, the person itself, would also leak out.
So then when Bob jumps in, how he can meet with Alice? yeah, this is very naive, but I don't know about these things. So
no, so the idea is that the equivalence principle is true. So Alice doesn't encounter anything weird happening at the horizon. There are no highly energetic particles, no firewall or anything like that. So Alice is not destroyed at the horizon.
Okay, but all her information are already
leaked out. So that's the problem, right? Alice herself exists and a copy of her information is also outside.
Okay, okay, okay.
That's the paradox, basically, yeah.
Okay, okay. Okay, okay, you can go ahead.
Yeah, sure. Thanks for the question. Yeah, so then a simple way around these paradoxes, let's focus on cloning, is that Bob takes an exponentially large time in the entropy to actually decode anything from the Hawking radiation. So if that happens, since the black hole takes a polynomial time in the entropy to evaporate, by the time Bob can actually decode Alice's diary, the black hole doesn't exist anymore. So then this paradox disappears. So you can't even do this thought experiment even in principle. So the main idea is that if Bob takes a long enough time, in this case, let's say it's exponential in the entropy, such that the black hole has already evaporated, then the question of cloning or actually verifying cloning never arises. And a similar argument goes through for some of these other paradoxes, such as EMPS. Their experiments are also not realizable if the decoding time for Bob is very large. Now, Kim, Tang, and Preskill kind of made this more concrete and put it in a very very quantum information language. They said that the Hawking radiation has to be pseudo-random. What that means is, if Bob makes any measurement on the Hawking radiation, it should be indistinguishable from a thermal state or a maximally mixed state. So if that is the case, if the Hawking radiation is close enough to the pseudo-random state, then Bob will take an exponential time to decode anything from the radiation. So this is kind of where the field stands right now, I think.
Can I add a question?
Sure.
So why is this cloning paradox a problem with black hole specifically and not any other quantum system?
No, in quantum mechanics, it just, since it's manifestly unitary, you don't have any issue.
But you assumed unitarity to derive the...
Yeah, that's true. So we expect that that there should be no cloning. So in the black hole context, we don't really know what's the way around that. I mean, you can do this thought experiment in principle,
right?
And you seem to observe cloning, but if the process is unitary, you shouldn't.
But supposing it's not a black hole, supposing it's like any other radiation, is there a paradox? There's no, like, is there a reason why there's no paradox?
Okay, I think one reason would be that black holes are fast scramblers, so maybe one might see it in quantum systems which are fast scramblers, which saturate this some bound on the Lyapunov exponent.
I see.
But again, we expect for unitary systems that this paradox shouldn't exist. But I don't really know why it's come up only in the context of black holes. But one reason I can think of is the scrambling property.
Okay.
That's the only reason you can actually perform this cloning experiment, because the scrambling time is so small that the information leaks out rather quickly to actually be able to do this.
Nice. Thanks.
I
have a related question maybe. So you mentioned that it is crucial that Bob and Alice talk to each other inside the black hole, right? To match their states, sort of.
Yeah.
To be sure that they have the same state. So isn't it something like what is called in quantum information theory classical communication, something? Or in that case, is there really a paradox around about whether it is cloning or something? Because there is also this thing called quantum teleportation, right? Where two people can, a person can decode a state into a more complex state, and another person can decode that state out of there. Mm-hmm. But that's not called cloning. So
In that case, in the teleportation case, what is happening is Alice is kind of transferring her state to Bob, who is in a faraway lab, let's say. And as you said, teleportation requires some classical communication, like a telephone between Alice and Bob. But yes, in the teleportation context, what happens is Alice actually does some measurements on her state.
Yeah, yeah.
So this state, Alice doesn't, at the end of the whole process, Alice doesn't have the state she started out with. So
yes,
at any time slice, there are no, there don't exist two copies of the same state.
Yes, but after, so are you saying that after the information of the diary scrambles out in the black hole and it comes out in the radiation, the same information is also available inside the black hole?
Exactly, yeah, yeah.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, that's okay. That's the, nice. Yeah, that's the idea.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? Because I'm done with the introduction essentially. Okay. Yeah, so now we kind of have this whole introductory idea of some idea about what black holes do to qubits which go in. Now we wanted to understand how these information processing properties of black holes, such as fast scrambling or this Hayden Preskill idea, or I mentioned the pseudo randomness, all of these ideas in more detail and more concretely. So that's the kind of reason why our model exists. But one question is why a physical model? So why not just do something like Hayden Preskill, where they have these nice abstract circuit models and understand black hole physics from there? But it's kind of obvious that these models are limited in because of the fact that they are so abstract. Some concrete questions one can address with a physical model is what class of observables in the radiation can be used to do the mirroring? What class of observables in the Hawking radiation would be able to decode Alice's diary? Then there's the converse question, what class of observables in the Hawking radiation, like what measurement concretely would you do? What mode would you measure to decode the interior? Then there are much more interesting questions, such as maybe using a physical model, one can actually construct these circuit models. And then one would get an actual prescription for how the circuit model is related to physics. And this is very typical in quantum information. So they construct these circuit models for, let's say, an atom interacting with a radiation system. So an atom interacting with a laser. So they have explicit constructions for unitary operators in that case. So it's possible in principle, given some physical model, some Hamiltonian or some dynamics, that one can construct circuit models out of it. This is a very question that I personally am quite interested in, building circuit models for black holes from physical models. Now, what is our model? This is like a cartoon of our model. So it's inspired by, again, inspired needs to be stressed. We are not deriving it from anything. The model is inspired by this idea of fragmentation, which Maldacena and Brill and others talked about. So the idea is that the near horizon geometry of near extremal black holes, they have some amplitudes to fragmental to multiple throats. And when any two of these throats, let's say they're EDS2, any two of these EDS2 geometries, when they come close enough to each other, by close enough, let's say sub-Planckian distances, then a large number of low energy states are known to appear. And these are what inspire some elements of our model. I personally have not studied fragmentation in much detail, but this is just an inspiration. So even if you haven't, you can just forget about it. So the taking inspiration from this idea of fragmentation, we construct a lattice model of the black hole horizon. So the dimensionality of the lattice is the same as the dimensionality of the black hole horizon. So in this picture, you have a two-dimensional black hole horizon, and my lattice is also 2D. So there are two elements you can see in the picture. One of them is these drum-like objects, which I have labeled to be EDS2 black holes. These are essentially SYK-like quantum dots, dual to JET gravity. And I think there have been some few lectures on JET gravity in the seminar series. So you might have seen JET gravity before. Then we make these guys interact via some gravitational charges, which are inspired by these low energy states which appear when these fragmented throats come close together. Now, these are the two main ingredients, which I'll describe one by one in a bit more detail in what follows. So now, the first thing to come to is these quantum dots, which are dual to JT gravity. So these have just one degree of freedom, which is this function T of u. And I call it Ti of u, where I labels each of the lattice site. So the only thing you need to know all correlation functions in any state of this quantum system is T of u. So if you know some, let's say you want to measure some two-point function, and you know what the two-point function looks like in vacuum, you can construct the two-point function in any other arbitrary state just if you know this function. And what is this function? This function is the reparameterization of the physical time. The physical time or the experimentalist time is u, and it's some function which reparameterizes time from u to t of u. Now I'll come to the gravity picture and write down a metric for you for JT gravity in the next slide, but this is kind of an overview of what is happening. There's just one degree of freedom which you need to know for these dots. Then the next thing is these gravitational hair, or these gravitational charges, which we call gravitational hair. Now these carry SL2R charges, which I label by these squarish looking QI, let's say. And now the idea is to make these two ingredients interact with each other, but the interaction has to be such that there is only one SL2R symmetry which corresponds to the unfragmented geometry. Now, let's say I have n of these SYK type quantum dots. Each of these SYK dots have an SL2R symmetry. So I would have an SL2R tensor n symmetry. So I need the interaction to be such that this is broken to just a single SL2R. And this would correspond to the isometry of the unfragmented horizon. Now the quantum dots have their own SL2R charges, as I mentioned. These can be written again, if you just know T of u, you can write these three components, these three SL2R charges, which I call Q plus, Q minus, and Q zero, in terms of derivatives of T and some ratios of them. Now one can define an SL2R invariant dot product of two of these charge vectors, so which is given in the equation here. So the SL2R invariant dot product of, let's say, a charge at site I and a charge at site j is defined to be this equation here. Now this would, I need to define this for our interaction equations, which will come in the next slide, but yeah. Now there's a black hole which is dual to each of these quantum dots, and it will have a mass which is given by the Schwarzschild derivative of these T of u's. The Schwarzschild derivative is defined for you in the slide. And this is the same as QI dot QJ. This is just the overall picture. I'll come to where the black hole mass of the dual black hole enters into the picture. Yeah, so the main idea is you have these two ingredients. One of them is these lattice of quantum dots and some gravitational hair on top. And these are talking to each other. The quantum dots have their own SL2R. The hair have their own SL2R. And I can define this SL2R invariant dot product. Now let's come to ADS2 or JT gravity. So we start off in pure ADS2, just the vacuum in Eddington-Finkelstein gauge. So the metric looks like the first black box on your slide. Then we perform a gauge preserving bulk diffeo, which is given by the second equation here. So which takes T to T of u, and rho is also transformed in some way. And you end up with a metric which looks like the third black box. Now this is the metric for a black hole in ADS2 with a mass given by essentially 1 by r square. This is the ADM mass for this black hole. And this goes through provided Schwarzschild of T of u is provided the mass of this dual black hole is equal to the Schwarzschild of T of u up to some sine and 2. So this is the main idea. You can map any the vacuum state to a black hole in ADS2, if you have a T of U, which takes you from the experimentalist time or the physical time U to some reparameterized time T. Now, this is, I'm just being very superficial about JT because I thought I would focus more on the information stuff instead of the JT stuff, but yeah. Now, in addition to all this, each of the throats has a null matter field, which has a conserved and traceless energy momentum tensor, which has the form in the top equation. So only the UU component is non-zero and the other components vanish. And just to show, U and R are the coordinates in this metric for the black hole, for the E-2 black hole. Now, if we just have matter, which is of this form, which has energy momentum of this form, then the JT gravity equations just tell you this, that the Schwarzschild prime of T of U, where prime denotes derivative with respect to U, that is just proportional to F of U. This is what the JT gravity equations will tell you. Now, this will all arise from the equation of motion for a bulk dilaton, which exists in JT, but let me not get into that for now. And the solving for the form of the dilaton in this case is also very simple. It's just 2 by r essentially. Yeah. So just to put everything in perspective, you have these two ingredients, these quantum dots, which are dual to E-2 black holes. So these quantum dots have only one degree of freedom, which is this time reparameterization, taking you from U to T of U. And this maps you from vacuum EDS2 to EDS2 black hole with mass equal to Schwarzschild of T of U. And you have these gravitational hair which carry their own SL2R charges. These are the main ingredients. Now let's couple them together. So the way we couple them is the first black box on your screen. So if you just look at the first equation, MI primes are the derivatives of the masses at each site with respect to U. These curly Qs are the SL2R charges of the quantum dots, and these squarish Qs are the SL2R charges of the gravitational hair. Now, the first equation kind of should remind you of a diffusion-like equation. But the only difference is our diffusion constant is not really a constant. It is QI prime. But that was kind of the inspiration behind this equation, to have some diffusion between the masses. The second equation, if you ignore the term which is proportional to 1 by lambda square, this is just basically a Klein-Gordon in a discretized form. The right-hand side would become the Laplacian in the continuum limit. And then there is this additional coupling term, which is proportional to 1 by lambda square. Now, because of this dot product in the first equation, it's manifest that we have only a single SL2R, because this dot product is invariant only if you do the same SL2R transformation on both of these guys. And given these coupling equations, you can write down a conserved energy, so which is just a sum of the masses, a kinetic term for the hair, which is just Q prime squared, and another term which will be grad square in the continuum limit.
Tanay?
Yeah.
So the first pair of equations, I'm trying to understand, where do they come from?
Yeah, so this is an inspired guess. I mean, it's not derived from anywhere. So for instance, the idea of having a diffusion-like equation was so that the masses would equilibrate eventually. And
you're just saying that like this is the definition of your system, like you're defining exactly. It. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. We're not deriving it from anywhere. The way it happened was the postdoc we were working with just kind of made a guess and then we solved it and it gives some interesting stuff out.
Yeah. I see. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, so now after we do the coupling described by these black boxes, the energy momentum tensor in each throat is modified, but it retains the same form. It is just of the same form where TUU is the only non-zero component. The other guys vanish and TUU takes the form given by the first equation on the page, which is essentially the term on the right hand side of the M prime equation. So the dilaton will again take the same form in this case as well. Just a small comment. Now, are there any questions about the definitions or the ingredients or anything like that? Okay. If not, I'll just move on to describe some static solutions of our model, which we identify with black hole microstates. So we let's see how we, in the first place, get static solutions. So let's look at, okay, let's invert the order that is in this black box. Let's look at the equation for the hair. Let me go back. So the equation for the hair is the second line in the first black box. So now we want static solutions, the most general static solutions one can think of. So the left hand side of the second equation has to be zero. So the only way to do that is as follows. The gravitational charges or the hair charges have to be proportional to the charges of the SYK dots and up to some overall constant. So if you ensure this, you can check that the equation I had shown you before would just vanish identically. Now, this is the most general way to do it. You can, of course, choose all of them to be equal or some special cases, but this is the most general way to do it. Then you want this equality, the fact that the hair are locked in, that's why I label it as QI lock, or the hair are proportional to the SYK charges. You want this equality to hold for all time. So that means the time derivatives of the hair should be the same at each site. Because were they different, at the next time step, this equality would cease to hold. So that tells me that the hair has to, the time derivative of the hair charges have to be uniform. They have to be the same at each site. Now, since the time derivative of the hair are the same at each site, the time derivative of the hair appear in the first equation on the first box. If you remember, I had one overall SL2R remaining, which I can still make use of. Now I have n of these three component SL2R vectors, which are all the same, which are all equal. So if I do an overall global SL2R rotation, I can rotate all of these n vectors into the zero direction. So I define these charges in the zero plus and minus directions a few slides ago. So since all of these n charges are the same, I can do a global SL2R and make them all aligned in the zero direction. Now that tells you the QI prime appearing in the first equation is only in the zero direction. So if I want to make the left hand side of the first equation vanish, I can do that by setting all the SL2R charges of the dots in the zero direction to be equal. That only that ensures that the first equation is zero. Now you have some additional degrees of freedom which correspond to the plus and minus component in this rotated frame. Those you can choose to be whatever you want. We just pick them uniformly at random, and that ensures a static solution. So this black box is essentially what describes a static solution of our model. If you haven't followed and all of the details, or if you're a bit lost right now, it's okay. But the main message to take is that all of the SYK dot charges, these curly Qs, have to be equal in the zero direction. The plus and minus directions don't matter. You can choose them randomly. If you remember just that from this part, that's enough for me. Then. Since now we have a static solution, on top of the static solution, our equations allow for some free oscillations of which we call QI rad. So these oscillations can just exist on top of these background static solutions. They don't affect or even talk to each other. But the configuration for these oscillations, which we call decoupled hair oscillations, since they are decoupled from the static background solution. They are described by the equations in this black box. So if you look at the second line in this black box, it just tells you that the coupling term doesn't exist for these guys. They just obey this free Klein-Gordon-like equation. And these are what we label by QI radiation or QI decoupled oscillations. So now we have a static configuration and which it can also support these free oscillations on top. So now the idea is to check if what I've described so far makes sense, if it at least behaves in some sense like a black hole or not. To do that, we will throw in shocks into one or more of these lattice sites in our model. And if our model is to be claimed to be sensible or viable, the following two at least should hold to be true. Once all the shocks have fallen in, once all the energy injections have gone into our model, the system should eventually relax to a new static configuration. Now, this is something we observe semi-classically with black holes. You throw in some matter, you go from one microstate to another. And the final microstate that you end up with in our model can be with or without these decoupled oscillations, hair oscillations on top. Now the energy that you're injecting should go almost fully towards increasing the total mass. This is also what one would expect. So to test this, we throw in some null shocks into our model. So these null shocks have the following energy momentum tensor given by this black box. So again, it has the same form, only the UU component is non-zero, and the UU component is basically proportional to a delta function at some particular, peaked at some particular time where you're throwing in the energy. So we are throwing in one or more shocks at some of the sites in our lattice model. And we are trying to see what happens, what the dynamics tell us. Now, just to show you what happens for some example. So this is what the energies look like for a periodic chain. So that means my horizon is just a one-dimensional circle. And we have five sites in this plot. So this is what the energies look like. The yellow curve on the top is the total energy for our model. Okay, it's constant, which is the first thing one needs to check. And then it jumps when the shocks enter in. And then again, it's constant. So at least at this level, the model is sensible. Then there is the red line, which is the total mass or the total energy of these SYK dots. They are also initially constant because we've started out in a static state. There's some jump because of the energy injection, of course. And then they again end up in a static configuration. Now, the blue curve is the energy in the hair or the energy in these gravitational charges. On the scale of this plot, it looks like it doesn't change much, which is true. Most of the energy of the shocks actually goes into the total mass. If you're injecting, let's say, 1 unit of energy, around 10 raised to minus 3 units are what enter into the hair. It's that small a factor. And we can actually take a continuum limit of our model. In the continuum limit, no energy will enter into the hair at all. All of the energy will enter into the SYK dots. Now, again, just to illustrate the point again, we start off in a static configuration. This plot is for each of the individual energies of each of the individual SYK sites. You start off in a static configuration. You're shocking at U equal to zero, the vertical line. You can see a jump in the green curve. So that tells you I've only shocked site one, so M1 is the only one that jumps. And you can see some relaxation, and then finally you end up again in a flat static configuration. So okay, the masses start off in a static configuration and end up in a static configuration. Now this is the most interesting plot out of all of these. So I'd ask you to remember just one thing out of all that, all the stuff that I said when I described the static solutions. which was that to have static solutions, we need the SL2R charges of the SYKs to all be aligned in the zero direction, and aligned and equal in the zero direction. So that's what we see in the beginning. All the SL2R charges in the zero direction for all the sites are the same. Then they kind of become disturbed because of the shock. And you can see that they eventually equilibrate again in the same frame, in the same SL2R frame that you started out in. So this is more evidence for the fact that we start off with a static configuration and end up in another static configuration. Now, these are the plots for the plus component of the SL2R charges of the SYKs. Again, you go from one static configuration to another. You can see the same thing for the, yeah, it's the same plot. Yeah, I forgot to add the minus plot. This guy should have been the plot for the minus charges, but you essentially see the same kind of saturation behavior for the minus charges as well. So we see that if you shock a static configuration of our system, it goes from one microstate to another microstate. And remember that we are choosing some parts of our configuration randomly. So this kind of qualitative behavior of going from one static to another static holds for any random initial static state that you choose. What we see is that the final static state or the final microstate, it has some decoupled oscillations which I described before. They just obey this free Klein-Gordon equation. And as I'll describe in what follows, these are what are important to realize this Hayden-Preskill idea in our case. So without wasting more time, I'll just come to the Hayden-Preskill idea, unless there are some questions now.
Tanay, maybe you could just take like a moment and sort of, because I feel like there was quite a bit there. So can you just sort of summarize the last two, three slides?
Yep.
Broadly.
Sure. Yeah. So I described.
Yeah, from the results on the null shocks, one sentence per whatever.
Yeah. So we're throwing in null shocks to check if our model is kind of walking and talking in the right way. So you see that you go from one static state to another because the total energies are flat. The energies in the SYK dots as well as the energies in the gravitational charges are both flat before and after the shock. So this is the main message from this slide. Then here I'm just zooming in. I'm looking at each of the individual energies of the SYKs, each of the individual masses of the dual EDS2 black hole. So here also you see I'm starting out with some initial static configuration. All each of the individual masses are flat, are time independent. At u equal to zero, some of the masses will jump because I'm throwing in some delta function shocks. And you can see finally, after some transient dynamics, they all relax back to some different masses, but they are still static at the end. So you're going from one static configuration of masses to another static configuration of masses. Now you can start off with any random initial choice of masses which are static. You will end up with a different choice of masses which will still be static. Now here, as I mentioned, for a static configuration of our model, we need the SL2R charges of the SYKs or the quantum dots to be the same in the zero direction. So that's why they start out as on the same line initially before u equal to zero. After the shock, they kind of become distorted, they separate out, but the dynamics of our model bring them back together and they end up on the same values at the end of our dynamics again. So this is more evidence for the fact that we are ending up in another static solution. Now, similarly, this was a plot to illustrate what happens to the Q plus charges. Now, the Q plus and Q minus charges, you can choose any way you want. It doesn't matter. As long as I'm choosing the other aspects of our model correctly, you will still have a static configuration. But here also, you see you start off in a static configuration, you relax to another static configuration. This should have been a different plot, but It's essentially the same for the other Q minus component as well. So yeah, this is the main kind of punchline to take away from this whole section, that our system is starting off in a static configuration. I'm throwing in some null shocks into one or multiple of these throats, and I will end up with another static configuration, which will be different from the one you started out with.
All right, thanks.
Yeah, so then as I mentioned before, here, let me just reiterate that once. This final static configuration or this final microstate that I'm mentioning, that has these decoupled hair oscillations. So let me just flash that equation once for you, which was described by this black box. So why I call them decoupled hair oscillations is because they just exist on their own without talking to the static background at all. So this is just completely decoupling from the SYK dots. These are just oscillations of the gravitational charges. So what we see after shocking is that the final state has some oscillations in these hair degree of freedom, which will be crucial to realize the a version of the Hayden-Preskill protocol, which I described in the introduction. So yeah, this protocol, as I mentioned, is called information mirroring. That's why we drew this nice cute diagram where Alice throws in some message into our model, which I've drawn as a chain of five SYK dots. And she throws in some message in the form of null shocks into our model. So the question is, if Alice encodes her message in the position and time ordering of the shocks. So by that I mean, is she shocking site one, site two, site three, what, and in what order? Does she shock site one first and then site two, or the other way around, and so on? So if she can encodes her classical message, this is all classical. If she encodes her classical message, instead of using zeros and ones, she can encode it in the positions and time orderings of these shocks. And if she does this, can Bob eventually decode this message somehow after some time? The answer to this turns out to be yes. Bob just has to study this decoupled radiation or these decoupled modes of these gravitational hair, which I mentioned before. If he studies them carefully enough, he can recover the positions and time orderings of Alice's shocks. Now, yeah, this is kind of illustrated in this cartoon-like figure. Alice throws in some secret message. Bob is just pulling out one hair, one of these squiggly blue lines. He feeds it into some decoding algorithm, and out pops a secret message again. Now, this is a more concrete schematic of what is happening. So let's look at it carefully. Let's start with everything to the left of this mixing box. That is the initial condition you start with. Time runs from left to right. So initially you can have some decoupled oscillations. We choose to start with no decoupled oscillations because that's the simpler decoding case to illustrate in a talk. So let's say this QI rad is zero, forget about that. There were these two components. One of them was the SL2R charges of the gravitational hair, which is given by the second line. These can be split into two parts again, but you don't need to worry about that too much. The third line is the SL2R charges of the SYK dots and the shocks. So what the left-hand side is telling you is you're inputting some initial configuration of the SL2R charges of the SYKs, which is the bottommost line, the shocks, and the gravitational charges into mixing. Now, mixing is just the dynamics of our model, which are scrambling up all these two or three pieces together and ending up in another static configuration. So after this mixing, or after the dynamics of our model settles down into another static microstate or another static configuration, Bob just looks at this QI rad, or what I call these decoupled oscillations, and does some decoding algorithm given by this box decoding, and he can extract the shock information. Now, this is the schematic of what is happening. I think, yeah, I spoke all of these tech stuff already. Yeah, so recall that the decoupled hair oscillations just obey this equation. And the examples I'm about to show you are for a five-site periodic chain. So we've all solved this system in our undergraduate. This is just a set of coupled harmonic oscillators. You can just do some coordinate transformations and obtain the normal modes for this system. And for a five-site periodic chain, you will end up with two normal mode frequencies for these decoupled hair oscillations. Now, this is what it looks like. So this is a plot of the Fourier transform of these decoupled hair oscillations for each of the five sites. So each of these five sites will have their own gravitational charges and their own oscillations. I just take a Fourier transform of those guys and plot them. You can clearly see two normal modes visible. One of them is around 30 and the other is around 17. This frequency is just decided by this coupling constant sigma from the previous slide. Now it turns out that Bob can decode the position and time ordering of the shocks by looking at only certain observables in the spectrum. Now these observables are the phase differences between these two modes. So let's say Bob is looking at site one, Q1. So Bob just needs to compute the difference between the phase of the normal mode at 30 minus the phase of the normal mode at 17. And he does that for each of the sites. So this phase difference of between the normal modes at each site is what will encode the information about the infolding shocks. But if you look at the amplitudes of these normal modes in the Fourier space, it turns out that these will be dependent on the initial state you started out with. So it's very complicated to decode any information about the infolding information from the amplitudes of these decoupled oscillations. So only one particular observable, these phase differences, actually encode information about the infolding shocks. Another observable, the amplitudes, seem to encode information about the initial state, the SYK charges, and so on. So just to show you how this decoding works, just to illustrate an example or two. So let's say Alice just throws in one shock. See, she shocks only one site out of five. This site is labeled by the blue dot. The other sites are all pink. The numbers on top of these dots indicate the phase differences between the two normal modes at each site. If you just stare at this diagram, you can see an approximate symmetry in the phase differences. So you can see the symmetry would tell us that it was the blue site which was shocked. Now you might think, okay, this might seem trivial. You are solving some classical equations and ending up with some symmetry. But this, remember that we are starting off with a highly asymmetric state. Since we are choosing the plus and minus components of the SYK charges randomly, so it is very non-trivial that the phases, just this particular observable, does not get scrambled or distorted by that initial randomness. It is just this particular observable that mirrors or that encodes information about the infolding shocks. As I mentioned, the amplitudes, they are heavily dependent on the initial configuration you started out with. So they will be highly asymmetric. It's hard to decode any information from them. So it is a non-trivial statement to be able to decode information of the infolding shocks from just one observable and not another. I mentioned the symmetry is seen only in the phase differences and not in the amplitudes. Now, similarly, we can do a decoding for two shocks. Again, the blue dots indicate which two sites were shocked. In the case of two shocks, we can also decipher the time ordering. We can't actually tell you the exact time difference between the shocks, but we can tell you which was shocked first and which was shocked later. The argument is again similar. These numbers indicate the phase differences at each site, the phase differences between the normal modes at each site. So you just look at the minimum and the maximum phase difference. So these two extrema are the two sides which were shocked. That's the first step. Now you know that they are separated by one site. Okay, if they are separated by one site, the site with the largest phase difference was the one shocked first. This is the decoding algorithm. You just look at the maxima, minima in the phase difference. If the two sites are separated by one, they are not nearest neighbor, then the maximum, the site with the maximum phase difference was shocked first. You can do something similar for the case when the extremum sites are nearest neighbors. In that case, the algorithm is reverse. The site with the maximum in phase difference was shocked later. Now, this is just to illustrate a concrete decoding algorithm for a five-site chain. The first comment I want to make is that this is decoding of classical information. So that's where we are so far. I'm not going to present any quantum decoding at all. Not yet anyway, hopefully in the next 6 months. But that is our result so far. We've observed decoding of classical infalling information from our model. But this is the standard steps one takes. If you look at any quantum information literature, they would start by studying the classical system first and then going to the quantum version. If you look at the Hayden-Preskill paper first, they study the classical Hayden-Preskill protocol first and then go on to the quantum one. So what I've shown you so far is a classical version of the Hayden-Preskill protocol realized in a five-site chain. Now, one can go to higher number of sites and lower number of sites. The algorithms change. One needs some different decoding procedure, but one can actually decode, and we've added some appendix in our paper which details how one can do this for 6 and 7 sites and 3 and 4 sites also. Are there any questions about this? Because this is the main results from the paper which is already out. What I'll describe later is ongoing work.
I don't have a question, but I just wanted to mention that the hour is up. So
I'll finish in 5 minutes.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so this what I've described so far were the main results of our paper, that we can do classical Hayden-Preskill. We can add Hawking radiation. It's pretty easy to incorporate. We just follow the recent work by these guys. Where they explicitly compute the page curve in JT gravity, which is coupled to a bulk two-dimensional CFT. And they couple it to a CFT bath, which allows the Hawking radiation to leak out. And the only thing one needs to add to our model is an additional term, which is proportional to the mass. So one just needs to add in the M prime equation, one just needs to add a term, which is minus alpha times M. Alpha is proportional to the central charge of this two-dimensional CFT that you're coupling to the JT. This is what they do in their model. We can replicate it, but instead of one JT, we have, let's say, 5 JTs. So we have 5 CFTs. Each of them will have these terms in their particular dynamics. I'll just skip this. This is just a slide with a screenshot from their particular paper. But we just repeat their computation in an attempt to compute a fragmented quantum extremal surface. This is something which is ongoing, which will hopefully be out early next year. But these are some preliminary results. This is a plot of the individual masses of each of the sites versus time. Now, in this case, I've incorporated a Hawking evaporation, which is at a very slow rate compared to the equilibration time scale of our model or the coupling constants of our model, these lambdas and sigmas from before. So the first thing to note is look at late time. You see some very slight decaying behavior of each of these masses. It's very slight because the central charge I've chosen is very small compared to our couplings. One also sees some equilibration behavior or some transient behavior between u equal to 0 and u equal to 0.5. So it would be interesting to see what the page curve behaves like in this time between 0 and 0.5. What happens to the page curve in this range? Because at very late times, we expect the page curve would be the same as what these guys have computed. Because we just have independently evaporating throats. And within each of these throats, we would compute the same entropy as they have before. So we would expect to end up with the same late time page curve as they have. What is interesting is the early time behavior between where this transient is occurring. What shouldn't happen is that the page curve should not reflect the initial microstate that we started out with. So the page curve should not have any transitions, any phase transitions, which would allow me to extract information about the initial configuration. This is something to keep in mind. If this happens, I think we just have to throw our model out. Yeah, this is what I like. So the late time behavior of each mass is, you can just fit it to an exponential decay. And they, you can see that they basically decay at their own rates. Now, just to tell you what's next and kind of conclude. So I've just described the classical version of the Hayden-Preskill so far. The next idea is to quantize parts of our system one by one and study decoding of quantum information, the quantum version of Hayden-Preskill. So we can quantize the hair, we can add Hawking radiation, put all three of these together and see what happens. Once we put all of them together, interesting questions about the structure of entanglement between these three subsystems arise. So we have a tripartite system, the Hawking quanta, the gravitational hair, and the interior or the SYK dots. So it's interesting to know or understand how they are entangled together. Then a question which I am very interested in is to try to construct quantum circuits from our dynamics. So this is very easy in principle. If you give me a unit tree which acts on HA tensor HB, I can construct a quantum circuit which describes the dynamics on HA. So this comes from the theory of open quantum systems, and people have explicitly constructed quantum circuits, as I mentioned before, for some physical models, such as an atom interacting with a laser. So something similar might be possible if our dynamics turns out to be simple enough. So this is something we are working on with some quantum information theorists from our department. Yeah, just to conclude, we've constructed a phenomenological model of a black hole, which has some desirable features such as relaxation from one static configuration to another. And we can explicitly demonstrate a classical information mirroring. We're kind of in the process of doing a lot of interesting follow-up work, including computation of the page curve, which would tell you the entropy for our model, studying quantum information mirroring, and also hopefully building quantum circuits out of our dynamics. Yeah, thank you for your attention.
Okay, I think that was very, very detailed talk. Are there any questions, perhaps?
So what? So from this model, are you expecting any kind of new predictions that you expect to make from this model?
Not yet, because we haven't quantized anything yet.
At this stage, you are verifying like known things about black holes, right?
But exactly. Yeah.
And you'll do the quantum thing also, but eventually you would want to make some predictions that don't already come from black holes.
That's right? True. Yeah.
So do you guys have anything in mind?
For instance, I mentioned what the page curve looks like for this fragmented setup.
Right.
So what they've studied is just the page curve for an ADS2 black hole. But our idea is our lattice can represent a higher dimensional black hole, which has fragmented. One might expect some interesting behavior in this earlier time page curve for such systems. Yeah.
I see.
And this idea of of hair, of this gravitational hair charges, I think mostly people have been studying bipartite systems. So Hawking radiation and interior.
Right.
So maybe one, in our case, it turns out that the information recovery occurs through the hair. So maybe you need, you do need the third subsystem too.
I see. Oh. Thanks.
Okay, maybe if there are no other questions, let's thank Tanay again for giving a really nice talk.